No, we're good.
Yep.
Okay, let's start. Thank you everyone for being here today. And those that are connected on Zoom. So as Ignacio mentioned, today I will be presenting some of the research from my dissertation. So the first thing is, what is canola? Not everyone knows what is canola, and can be also known as oilseed rape, rapeseed, or colza, depending on the region where we are. And it's a result of breeding efforts. And basically, this crop has a very tiny package of small seed with high quantity of oil and protein. So what we it is used for canola. So after our farmers harvest the crop, usually the seeds go into a crushing process to obtain mainly the oil that can be used for edible oil or as a source for biofuel. And also the second most important use is the meal, the canola meal. And it's, as I mentioned before, is the seeds have high protein and is used for animal feed. So just to give you a brief context of the global production and where this crop is mostly produced. First is the second most relevant oilseed crop in terms of production and in terms of protein meal, high protein meal, and is the first main source of vegetable oil. So almost 90% of the production is concentrated in 10 countries. And two-thirds are focused on only three countries, leading with Canada with 27% and following by China and India. So let's focus now and let's zoom in on the regions, on the North American regions where we have two countries on the top 10 list. So we have Canada as the largest seed producer, and we have the USA and Mexico that are two of the largest oil importers. So the demand of canola here in North America and basically in the USA and Mexico far outplaces the supply. So there is a very strong market for this crop in this country. So let's see where are the main the main two type of canolas and where it's produced. So most of the canola in America is produced on the northern Great Plains as a spring canola that is usually planted between March and May, depending on the region where we are, and is harvested by September. But there is another type of canola that is winter canola. It's a biannual type, and it's most suitable for the production is most suitable for southern regions that are warmer regions. And this, as I mentioned before, is a biannual type of crop, and is seeded usually around the end of September, and goes through on the fall, and had a period of overwintering, and later when the temperature gets warmer, regrow and is harvested around June. So let's talk about winter canola, what some of the advantages that has winter canola. So it's a great rotational crop. The inclusion into the rotation with wheat had proven to be successful and provide alternatives to the farmer that only relies on wheat markets, on the prices of the wheat market. And usually farmers in the regions where winter canola is produced experiment higher yields than spring canola. And this is basically because the winter canola flowering period is earlier under cooler temperatures. So we experiment a longer seed filling period, so we have a higher yield potential. So if it's so great, why is not that common and we have only that 2% of production in the US. And I forgot to mention that in the US, most of the canola is on the in North Dakota state as a spring canola. So today I will present in only three chapters of my dissertation. The first two will be a focus on the main challenge of canola production. And the last one will be focused on the plantation expansion and the impacts on the future weather scenarios. So first, winter canola survival. This is a huge challenge for winter canola here in the Southern Grand Plains. And so as I told you before, winter canola is seeded on the fall. And something really relevant is to know and to have the correct planting day. The planting day window is not really long, it's kind of short. And for just an example, if we plant too early, we could have too much growth and the crown of the plant, that is basically the where the growing point is, could get too high and get exposed to winter conditions and adverse winter conditions, like wind or cold, extreme cold temperatures. But as the opposite, if we plant too late, we can have too little growth and the plant is doesn't get enough reserves and carbohydrates on the roots to survive the winter. So after we planted on the fall, the plants get into a rosette stage to overwinter, and a lot could happen in this winter. There are several environmental conditions and diverse conditions that could happen. And based on those conditions, we can have different outcomes, right? So one outcome, we can see more plants on the spring when the crop regrow. We can have these type of conditions, or we can have these type of conditions with lower survival. As I mentioned before, we have different outcomes. So we have positive outcomes, but also we could have negative outcomes. And what happened is that usually farmers don't measure the survival and say, okay, based on the level of survival that I have, I will keep with the crop. No, they just basically evaluate the condition of the overall field, and they could start to think on replanting either the canola, spring canola, or most likely another crop, another summer crop. So moving to the objective of this third chapter about winter canola. First, we wanted to identify the main factors that impact winter canola in the winter. Later, we wanted to build models based on historical weather data for each site. And later, the last one, we wanted to define the areas of adaptation of the germ plants or the genotypes, and if there is any potential for development of new varieties. So moving into methods, basically we use two main data sets. One was the National Winter Canola Variety Trials. That is a data set that has several stages, several genotypes, and several sites. And we filter that data set, and we include only for this analysis and the result that I will be presenting today, we include only site years that had a winter survival ratings as a percentage. And the second data set that we use, we gather weather information from group information, really related to temperature, radiation, precipitation, and velocity, and so on. So what we did with these two main data sets. The first thing that we did was to define the cold period. And basically, we defined the cold period as the first day and the last day when the mean daily temperatures were zero degrees Celsius. And later, during this cold period, we calculate 39 meteorological predictors to identify the main survival drivers. And some of, I don't have the time, I mean, for the sake of time of this presentation, I can't mention all of them, but basically we gather, basically we went through the literature and we explored the one that could potentially explain survival. So on the field data set, on the variety trials, the mean was 84%, but range anywhere from 0 to 100%. So there is a large range of variation. And where is this large variation coming from? And so the first thing that we did was to run a random effects model. And I want to mention that all the analysis presenting today, all the statistical analysis, we use our platform to make all the statistical analysis. And so we run a random effects model and we identify the most of the highest variation was coming from the environment. And later we use a k-mean algorithm to cluster all the ideas into three different classes. So we cluster them, the algorithm cluster, and identify three different groups. A group with a low survival, around 30%, a group with mid survival, about 70%, and a group of high survival, about almost 100%. So later we use a conditional inference tree model to identify not only the most important meteorological factors, but also the breakpoints of those. So this is telling us the main variables and the quantity or the quantification or values of those variables that define each level of survival. So how we could use this to quantify the probabilities of having these three types of levels of survival. So we use the train tree model and we predict and classify each side year into one survival class. So for each side year, we have a low survival, medium survival, high survival. And we did this for each side over four cold periods using the historical weather data. So basically we apply the train tree model rules to all the cold periods for each side. And for each side, we have some years with poor survival conditions, some years with medium, and some years with high conditions. So basically for each side, we just calculate the proportions of each class over that 4 year period. So now the next question is where we have this type of different levels of survival, right? So mainly we found a higher frequency of high winter survival conditions in the southern of the Grand Plains, south region of the Grand Plains, and near the East Coast. Now, when we move into more continental conditions where we have more extremes and diverse conditions, we start seeing more medium levels of survival. And when we move north, we start seeing really low, more frequency of low levels of survival. So the next thing was to group all the shale data that we have, and basically we evaluate the performance of all these shale types under all the environmental survival conditions. So now we are going to look at the winter survival level based on the environmental survival conditions. To classify this, we subset only the genotypes that were evaluated at these ones under each condition. So you will see that in this step, we have less locations. I will show later, but that is because we did a subset of the genotypes and we wanted to focus on the performance on each genotypes under diverse conditions. So some genotypes, we classify them as tolerant based on the response of the winter survival response under each condition. And based on that, the same the different responses, we classify the second group as semi-tolerant. With this group had a high number of varieties, and later we classify the third group as semi-susceptible with 56 varieties, and the last group was a susceptible genotype group, and only with 10 genotypes or varieties. So where are each of these groups of genotypes more frequent in the US and more adapted? In which regions are there? And basically we see that there is a large widespread of semi-susceptible and semi-tolerant genotypes or genotype groups. And if we remember the regions with higher winter survival problems that were many here in the central part of this graph and in the north, we can see that there is a need for more tolerant varieties. So as the conclusion of this first chapter, the main drivers of winter canola survival or the environmental drivers were related to minimum and maximum temperature, the fluctuations of these temperatures over the cold period of the winter, and the wind chill temperature. And based on the models that we performed in this study, we found a higher frequency of good survival in the southeast region of the US. And lastly, the third objective was to define the areas of germ plants adaptation to see if we have more a need of more more development of varieties, and there is a potential to develop more winter kill tolerant varieties. So now that we have one of the main challenges is winter survival, I want to present the second challenge that usually canola has. One of the main challenges is the heat or abiotic stress and the impacts on final seed yield and the quality. And when I say quality, I refer to oil and protein concentration. So as we know, there is a higher frequency of heat and drought extreme events, mainly during the summer months. And in the main production regions of canola, the production is expanding into more marginal, drier and warmer areas. And this could challenge the seed supply and the quality of those seeds. And basically we found in the literature really contrasting results. So the responses to these different stresses are a little bit unclear. So how temperature and water stress affect canola? So our objective of this study were to first quantify the impact of heat and drought stresses on canola seed yield and quality, and to study specific short-term stresses also on canola seed yield and quality. So moving into methods, the first thing that we did was to conduct a literature review on the main effects of the stresses on the response variable that we wanted to study. And we select 37 articles spread over 12 countries. All of the articles were related to drought stress, and we gathered around 800 observations. So how we can estimate the effect of this, each type of stresses. And we use a Bayesian random effect meta-analysis to calculate the effect sizes relative to the control. So we on all the studies, on the 37 articles that we select, we had some studies studying the heat effects, some other studies studying the drought effect, and we focus only on the impose or manipulate treatments. And later we found studies with under control experimental conditions, either in greenhouses or grow chambers, and in field conditions, or mainly for the heat stress under heat tents in the field. And later we classified different treatments based on the duration and the timing. And the duration we classified as short or long based on how many growth stages were the stresses imposed. So short stresses were imposed only in one growth stage, and long stresses were imposed in either two or more growth stages. And the timing was defined as early when were imposed before flowering, or late when were imposed after flowering. And these treatments, all the combination of these treatments were classified on, well, were evaluated for each of these three response variables. So for the sake of time of this presentation, I won't be able to show all of these combinations of treatments and the three response variables. So I will just focus on the overall effects on the heat and drought on these three response variables. So here we have the change over the control expressed as percentage. And let's focus first on heat stress and drought stress on seed quality. And we found that heat stress decreased by 5% seed oil concentration and by 5% seed protein concentration, an increase by 5% seed protein concentration. And this is not, basically this is a change over the control. It's not like had a 5% less of seed oil. And when we look at drought effects, we found that there were neutral effect on over effects of drought stress on seed quality. And now let's look into yield. And basically yield was highly impacted with a bit more of almost 20%. And the highest negative impacts were based on seed yield, these two on the overall response for these two types of stresses. So the next question was to identify which specific growth stages had the most negative impact. So let's look first at oil. And we see no changes on on stresses imposed on vegetative stages or flowering stages. And this again is a percent change over the control. And Also, we didn't found no changes when imposed on flowering, but the highest impacts were when the stresses were imposed on the pot setting stage, with a reduction of 6%. Later, let's look into protein. And basically, the highest impacts were at flowering stage with 14%, but we can see that there is start to have a reduction when moving into pod setting stages or seed filling stage. And finally, seed yield. The highest impacts were during pod setting with 36% of reductions. And basically, the highest impacts were on the pod setting stages, but also it's something important to see here that we also have a large range of variation in these stages. So the conclusion of this second chapter that I'm presenting today, heat, reductions on seed yield and on concentration and increased protein concentration. And drought had a reduced yield, but had neutral effect on seed quality. The highest impacts on the short-term stresses were at the pod setting stages. So now we have studied the two of the main challenges of canola. And now we wanted to see how the future weather projections impact impact the canola seedbeds. And this is focused on winter canola in the US. So as I mentioned before, there are more extreme events, mainly during summer months, but also the future weather projection says that there will be increases on precipitations and temperature during the winter and spring. And this highlights the relevance of studying more winter crops, such as winter canola. And winter canola could satisfy the increasing demand for edible oils. So crop simulations models are a very useful tool to explore different weather scenarios and how these different projections of the weather scenarios impact on the final crop production. So how canola will be affected in the future weather scenarios? And we wanted to explore first basically two different two contrasting weather scenarios. So the objectives were to quantify changes in yield due to future climate scenarios and to explore the yield changes over time from the beginning of the century until the end of the century, and identify the regions more suitable for future expansion of canola. So we use again the national trials data set, and we filter the data based on sites with yield, flowering date, maturity date, and management practices. We gather soil data from sorghum and daily long term weather data from mesonet, mostly related to temperature, radiation, and precipitation. And basically, what we did with this, we integrate all these data sets into one single platform, and we use APSIN Next Generation platform, and we use the generic winter canola culture. So the first step was to simulate and compare how these simulations perform and to compare the simulation versus the observed values. So basically we wanted to validate these simulations. And here let's focus first on the phenology traits that are flowering and maturity. And here we are seeing the days after flowering, day after sowing, sorry. And we can see an overall good performance of phenology traits. And when we look at seed yield, we can see that the overall the model underestimates seed yields. And this was expected due to the large number of factors that could impact final seed yield. But basically, we had a good or acceptable model efficiency of QCA of 0.62. And based on the literature, these numbers and this metrics performance, this performance are according to the literature. And when the basically when we compare with studies analyzing similar things. So the next step to, so now that we identify that the model performed well, we wanted to assess the future weather. And we focus on two sub-regions on the US, on the central region and the east region. And we use the future weather projection changes on temperature and precipitation mainly. And basically where these changes were coming from. And we use the shared socioeconomic pathways, the SSP. And this is a very simplified graph to show you just that the SSP 2.6 has less extreme conditions or more mild conditions, or are conditions that we want to have, or less extreme conditions. And the SSP 8.5 has more extreme conditions with more greenhouse gases emissions and no policies making in this regard. And we use three future periods, the near future, the mid future, and the far future. So the first thing that we did was a special clustering. And we used the historical weather of each site. And we evaluate the changes, or we modify the changes of non-temperature and precipitation based on those pathway projections. And basically, we evaluate the yields on the current weather. And using climate control model in APSIN, we apply these changes from the projections to the current weather, and we simulate the yields on the near future, mid future, and far future. And we did this to observe the overall trends on each side from the beginning of the century and the end of the century. And here is a very simple explanation to show you what we did. So based on these yields for each site, we observed different type of responses. And basically we found sites with positive responses or slopes. We found a site with negative responses, neutral responses, or high negative responses. So we retrieve the slope of the each site regression, and we use a Fuse means algorithm, and we help cluster these all the locations. So where are these type of these different shell cluster located? So if we look at the SSP 2.6 scenario, future weather scenario with low greenhouse emissions and CO2 emissions of zero around 2075, we can see more stable trends here on the slopes. And basically the positive trends are more focused on the central, on the south central region of the Great Plains. Now let's look on the to the worst or the most extreme weather protections and the SSP 8.5 with very high greenhouse emissions and triple CO2 emission by 2075. We start seeing more variable trends with higher slopes. And we can see that there is a larger area with positive trends towards the east of the US, the southern east. So as a conclusion of this last chapter, the projections, future weather projections favor winter canola productivity in a large area of the US. And basically sites on the central east of the US have higher potential yield gains. So as a summary of the three chapters, not the chapter one, it's the chapter two. I forgot to modify that. So the first chapter that I presented was about winter canola survival, and the main take-home messages were the main driver were related to temperature, its fluctuations, and the wind chill. There is a large area in the central east of the US high winter survival. And this could be pushed north with more genetic improvement. The second chapter that I present today related to the abiotic stresses and the impacts on seed yield and quality. We found that yield was reduced mostly with, the highest reductions were with heat and drought stresses in yield. And quality was affected only by heat stresses. And the highest negative impacts were in short-term stresses imposed at post-sale. And the last summary conclusions, the yield responses to future climate scenarios, the projections favor winter canola in the central US, and these positive trends expanding toward the east under more extreme conditions.